Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present Before Your Memory Fades, a novel by Toshikazu Kawaguchi, translated from Japanese by Jeffrey Trousselot, performed by Kevin Shen. If you could go back, who would you want to meet? 1. The daughter. Why are you in Hokkaido? Kei Tokita's voice sounded tinny coming from the handset.
Hey, relax. It's okay.
Nagare Tokita was hearing his wife's voice for the first time in 14 years. He was in Hokkaido, Hakodate to be exact. The city of Hakodate is full of Western-style houses dating from the early 20th century. Those houses, dotted throughout the city, have a unique architectural style, characterized by Japanese ground floors and Western upper floors. The Motomachi area, whose name means original town, located at the very base of Mount Hakodate, is a popular tourist destination. Its old town charm is enhanced by such popular historic sites as the former public hall, a rectangular concrete electricity pole, the first ever erected in Japan, and the red brick warehouses in its historical bay area. Kei, on the other end of the phone line, was far away in Tokyo, at a certain cafe that offered its customers the chance to travel through time. It was called Funiculi Funicula. She had traveled 15 years into the future from the past in order to meet her daughter. In that Tokyo cafe, she only had a brief time before she had to drink her cooling coffee. As he was far away in Hokkaido, in northern Japan, Nagare had no idea how far her coffee had cooled already. He was therefore careful to stick to the matter at hand.
There's no time to explain why I'm in Hokkaido. Please, just listen.
Of course, Kei was well aware that there was no time.
What's that? There's no time? I'm the one with no time.
She sounded upset. But Nagare paid no attention.
A girl is there, right? Who looks like she might be in middle school?
What? A schoolgirl? Yes, she's here. The same one who visited the cafe about 2 weeks ago. She came from the future to get a photo with me.
It had been 2 weeks ago for Kei, but she was referring to something that for Nagare happened a whole 15 years ago.
She's got big, round eyes. And she's wearing a turtleneck?
Yes, yes. What about her?
Okay. Just calm down and listen. You've accidentally traveled 15 years into the future.
Like I told you, I can hardly hear what you're saying.
A howling gust of wind had struck Nagare just as he was about to tell her something crucial. It was blowing a gale down his phone, making it next to impossible to communicate. Pressed by the lack of time, Nagare hurried.
Anyway, that girl you're looking at, he said, louder.
Eh, what? That girl?
She's our daughter.
What?
The phone in Nagare's hands fell completely silent. Then, instead of Kei's voice, he heard the middle pendulum clock in Funiculi Funicula begin chiming a familiar dong, dong. Letting out a small sigh, he began explaining calmly.
You agreed to travel 10 years into the future, so you think that your child will be about 10, but there was some kind of mistake and you traveled 15 years. It seems 10 years, 15 hours, and 15 years, 10 hours got mixed up. Just look at the time of the middle pendulum clock. It says 10 o'clock, right?
Uh-huh.
We heard about it when you got back. But right now, we are in Hokkaido for unavoidable reasons that I won't go into because there's no time.
Nagare had rattled through this explanation, but now he paused.
Anyway, you don't have much time left, so just have a good look at our all-grown-up, fit-and-well daughter and return to your present, he said gently and hung up.
From where he was standing, Nagare could see all the way down the straight, sloping street to the sprawling blueness of the ocean, and the sky beyond
which seemed to crown Hakodate Port. He swung back on his heel and walked into the cafe. Da-ding-dong! Hakodate boasts many sloping streets. 19 of them have been given names, including 20 Astride Rise, which stretches up from Japan's oldest electricity pole, and 8 Banner Rise, which starts near the red brick warehouses of Hakodate's touristy bay area. Others include Fish View Rise and Ship View Rise, which climb from the Hakodate waterfront. Further over the hillside are Cockle Rise and Green Willow Rise, which climb towards Yachigashiracho, meaning head of the valley. But there is one sloping street that the tourist maps don't show. Locals refer to it as No Name Rise. The cafe where Nagare was working was halfway up No Name Rise. Its name was Cafe Donna Donna, and a peculiar urban legend was attached to a particular seat in that cafe. Apparently, if you sat on that seat, it would take you back in time to whenever you wanted. But the rules were extremely annoying and a terrible nuisance. 1. The only people you can meet in the past are those who have visited the cafe. 2. There is nothing you can do while in the past that will change the present. 3. In order to return to the past, you have to sit in that seat and that seat alone. If the seat is occupied, you must wait until it is vacated. 4. While back in the past, you must stay in the seat and never move from it. 5. Your journey begins when the coffee is poured and must end before the coffee gets cold. The annoying rules don't end there either. Be that as it may, today, once again, a customer who has heard this rumor will visit the cafe. When Nagare returned from his phone call, Nanako Matsubara, sitting at one of the counter stools, came straight out and asked, Nagare, why didn't you stay in Tokyo? Do you still think it was a good idea to come here? Nanako was a student at Hakodate University. Wearing her light beige top tucked into her baggy trousers, she looked kind of trendy. Her makeup was lightly applied, her hair loosely permed and tied back with a scrunchie. Nanako had heard that Nagare's deceased wife would be visiting from the past to meet her daughter at the Tokyo cafe. Considering it was a one-time only chance to meet the wife he had not seen for 14 years, Nanako thought it was strange Nagare decided to greet her over the phone rather than see her in person.
Yeah, maybe,
Nagare replied vaguely as he walked past her and went behind the counter. On the stool next to Nanako sat a sleepy-looking Dr. Saki Muraoka with a book in her hand. Saki worked in the psychiatric department at one of Hakodate's hospitals. Both she and Nanako were cafe regulars. Didn't you want to see her again? Nanako's inquisitive eyes stayed focused on Nagare, a giant of a man nearly 2 meters tall.
Sure, but I had to respect the facts.
Which were?
She came to see her daughter, not me.
But still.
It's fine. I admit it has been a while, but my memories are still very much alive.
Nagare meant he would do anything he could to make the time between mother and daughter more precious. You are so kind, Nagare, Nanako said admiringly.
Jesus,
he retorted as his ears flushed red. No need to get embarrassed.
I'm nothing of the sort, he replied,
promptly disappearing into the kitchen to escape her. Taking his place, Kaze Tokita, the waitress, appeared from the kitchen. Over her white shirt and beige frilly skirt, she wore an aqua blue apron. She was 37, but her free-spirited and happy-go-lucky demeanor gave her the air of a younger person. What number question are you up to? Now that Kaze was behind the counter again, the subject of the conversation changed. Question 24. It was Saki, sitting next to Nanako, who replied. Showing a complete lack of interest in Nanako's conversation with Nagare, Saki had instead been reading her book attentively. Oh, yes,
Nanako chimed in, as if suddenly remembering. She cast a furtive eye at the book in Saki's hands. Saki flicked back several pages and read aloud. What if the world were ending tomorrow? 100 questions. Question 24. There is a man or woman with whom you are very much in love. If the world were to end tomorrow, which would you do? 1. You propose to them. 2. You don't propose because there is no point. So, which is it? Saki had pulled her gaze from the book and was looking at Nanako.
I'm not sure which I would do.
Come on, which?
Well, which would you do, Saki?
Me? I think I would propose.
Why?
I don't like the idea of dying with regrets.
Oh, I guess that's a fair point.
Eh? Nanako, are you saying you wouldn't propose?
Pressed to answer, Nanako tilted her head.
Oh, I don't know, she said softly. Well, maybe if I knew for certain that he loved me, I would. But if I wasn't sure how he felt, I probably wouldn't.
Really? Why not?
Saki seemed unable to accept what Nanako was saying.
Well, if I knew he loved me, I wouldn't be presenting him with a dilemma, would I?
No, I guess not.
But if he had never thought about me in that way before, then proposing would force him to think about me differently, and I would hate to add to his worries.
Oh, and that does actually happen, with men particularly.
Like on Valentine's Day, when some guy gets chocolate from a woman he has never thought about before, suddenly he becomes all conscious of her.
I'd feel pretty rotten if I caused someone extra worries just at the time the world is about to end. I also wouldn't like it if I didn't get a reply. So, although proposing to someone might be meaningful, I don't think I would do it.
I think you're taking it too seriously, Nanako.
Oh, really?
Definitely. It's not as though the world is ending tomorrow anyway.
Yeah, I guess so.
This chatter had been shuttling back and forth since before Nagare had gone outside to take the phone call.
What about you, Kazu? Which would you do?
Nanako leaned forward on the counter. Saki also looked towards Kazu with much interest.
Well, I'd... Da-ding-dong! Hello, welcome!
Kazu called out automatically in the direction of the entrance upon hearing the bell. In an instant, she put on her waitress face. On seeing that, Nanako and Saki were no longer pressing her to answer the question. But rather than a customer entering the cafe, in walked a girl wearing a light pink dress.
I'm back,
she called out energetically. Her name was Sachi Tokita, Kazu's 7-year-old daughter. She was lugging a heavy-looking bag on her shoulder and gripping a postcard in her hand. The postcard was from Koku Shintani, her father and Kazu's husband, who was a world-renowned photographer. He had married into and hence taken the surname of the Tokita family, but worked under his own name. His job involved constantly zipping around the world photographing landscapes, and he only spent a few days each year in Japan. Shintani therefore made postcards of the photos he took and frequently sent them to Sachi.
Welcome back,
greeted Nanako. Kazu was looking behind Sachi at the young man following her in.
Good morning,
said one Reiji Ono, a part-time employee at the cafe. Wearing casual attire of denim jeans and white t-shirt, Reiji was a little out of breath. Beads of sweat had formed on his forehead, a clear sign he had climbed the hill in a hurry.
We just happened to arrive at the same time, Reiji said to explain why he had entered with Sachi. Not that anyone had asked.
Reiji disappeared into the kitchen, from where he could be heard greeting Nagare. They were about to begin preparing for the busy lunchtime period, which would start in 2 hours. Sachi took a seat at the table next to the large window that commanded a stunning view across Hakodate Port. She appeared to be treating it as her own private study booth. There were other customers in the cafe besides Nanako and Saki. An old gentleman in a formal black suit was seated at the table closest to the entrance,
and a woman roughly the same age as Nanako was at a four-seater table. She had been there since opening time, doing nothing but gazing dreamily out of the window. The cafe opened rather early, at 7 a.m., to catch the tourists visiting the morning market. Sachi heaved her bag onto the table. Based on the unexpectedly loud thump, something heavy was obviously inside.
What's in there? Have you been to the library again?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.